Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Red Summer, the summer of 1919 and the awakening of Black America, by Cameron McWhirter, narrated by L.J. Ganser. Chapter 1. Carswell Grove. There has been nobody suffered in this matter like I have. I did not do nothing at all to cause that riot. Joe Ruffin. April 13th, 1919, was perfect for a celebration. As Joe Ruffin set out to do his morning chores that Sunday, the sky was cloudless and blue. The temperature was in the high 70s, normal for spring in East Georgia. The 60-year-old man started the day at his barn, rushing to feed his pigs, cows, and horses, so he would not be late. He had sent his children ahead to the Carswell Grove Baptist Church in one of the family's two cars, a Buick 6. Ruffin would follow later. The church festival was to mark its 52nd anniversary. Preachers from several counties were coming to deliver sermons. The choir would give a special performance. More than 3,000 people would be on hand for a gala cookout of roast pig and fried chicken. Though Ruffin was not a Carswell Grove member, he had been asked to speak as a prominent black mason and treasurer of another black church. Ruffin had lived his entire life amid fields of cotton and sugarcane east of Millen, the seat of Jenkins County. The land he tilled was once part of the plantation where his parents worked as slaves. Ruffin remained on good terms with the Daniel family, the former slave owners. Ruffin owned almost 113 acres. He ran 5 to 7 plows a season, a substantial operation for anyone in that part of Georgia at the time, and a major accomplishment for a black farmer. Unlike many blacks in the area, he could read and write, though census records did not report him having any formal education. Many of the years had been tough. Several times Ruffin had to mortgage tracts of land. He even took out loans on his mules and horses to cover debts. He had a large family. The 1910 census recorded 3 sons and 4 daughters living with him, plus another son and his family down the road. Ruffin was a widower. 2 sons, John Holliday, 26, and Henry, 13, lived at home. Lewis Ruffin, in his late 20s, farmed nearby. A 4th son, Joe Andrew Ruffin, 24, served with the U.S. Army in France. He was due home in time for the fall harvest. Whatever Ruffin's past struggles, 1919 was shaping up to be profitable. Cotton was fetching extraordinary prices, averaging more than 35 cents per pound, the highest ever. The Great War, which the United States entered in April 1917, was a boon for cotton. Textile mills needed tons of it for uniforms and other goods. The war's end, the previous November, had opened a broader market for cotton. Mills across the world needed it for civilian clothes. Supply was limited, as the ineluctable spread of the boll weevil reduced production in many parts of the South, including Georgia. Higher prices, fueled in part by cotton scarcity, helped farmers. The previous month, Congress boosted the price of cotton further by passing an amendment to the Federal Cotton Futures Act, making it easier for speculators to make bids. As global demand for cotton increased, futures skyrocketed. This spike was a windfall for Ruffin and millions of other southern farmers from Virginia to Texas. Jenkins County, Georgia, lay in the lower third of a swath of cotton farmland that extended from eastern Virginia into southern Alabama. From colonial days, the region had evolved into a network of plantations, cotton storehouses, and small towns grouped along a major road that later supported a railroad running south from Augusta to the Atlantic port of Savannah. Jenkins was rural and poor, like most counties in the region. Blacks accounted for almost 2/3 of its population. Many blacks in the county were illiterate, and election records indicate that only a handful were allowed to vote. All county government officials, from commissioners to police, were white. Most blacks in Jenkins County were sharecroppers renting land from white landlords, but a growing number owned property, a phenomenon occurring all over the South. In the first decades of the 20th century, despite the legal barriers imposed by Jim Crow, the number of acres owned by black farmers rose. In Georgia, black ownership jumped by 75% from 1899 to 1919. These landowners formed the respectable classes of black society in southern towns. They sat on church boards and led social groups. They generally had good relations with white business owners and politicians, serving as go-betweens when racial friction erupted. In the late morning of this particular April Sunday, Joe Ruffin was the embodiment of this new class, having spent a lifetime navigating the racial restrictions of Southern life. Through luck and hard work, he had prospered and never gave offense to any white man in the county. By the late afternoon of that April 13th, however, almost every white man in Jenkins County wanted Joe Ruffin dead. Around 11:30 a.m., Ruffin's youngest son, Henry, came back to the farm to get his father. Masons at the festival had asked for him. Ruffin changed into his best Sunday clothes, then got in his second car, a late-model, high-powered Ford touring car, and headed down the road. Henry stayed at the farm. The 15-mile drive from Ruffin's farm near Billy's Branch to the church was cut with swampy creeks and hollows. The roads were unpaved. The car drove past acre upon acre of young cotton plants, very low to the ground, with thin, waxy leaves. Jenkins County is in the middle part of the state near the Savannah River Valley, where Georgia's Piedmont slopes gradually toward the coast. Georgia's famous red clay is sandier in this part of the state, and a paler shade of orange. Ruffin could see cultivated land for miles, broken up by copses of loblolly pine and scrub oak, as well as thickets of holly and cypress. Hawks and buzzards circled the sky. Sometime after 2 p.m., Ruffin reached Big Buckhead Church Road, the final road leading to the festival. The dirt road had been around since the earliest settlers cut through the forest. As he crossed Buckhead Creek Bridge, Big Buckhead Church, one of the oldest inland white congregations in the South, was on his left. Across the road, mossy obelisk grave markers of Confederate veterans stood in a small cemetery. In the closing days of the Civil War, when Ruffin was a young boy, Union and Confederate cavalry battled there. The rebels lost, hundreds were killed. Carswell Grove was founded 2.5 years after the battle, in the midst of the social turmoil caused by the Confederacy's collapse. After the war, whites at Big Buckhead Church kicked out blacks, who for generations had sat in segregated pews. Porter W. Carswell, a white judge who owned nearby Bellevue Plantation, gave black congregants 2 acres of scrubland to erect their own place of worship just down the road. The congregants named their new church in his honor. By 1919, Carswell Grove Baptist Church boasted more than 1,000 members, most of them sharecroppers. The yearly celebration of the church's founding was one of the largest African-American gatherings in East Georgia. As Ruffin drove up the low ridge, he saw throngs of black men, women, and children milling about the grounds. They were talking and laughing. It was the cacophony of a large, joyous group. Ruffin parked his car and joined them. After a short time, Ruffin remembered that he had left the door to his house unlocked and decided to drive home. He got in his car, but the swelling crowds blocked the road. He drove as far as he could, almost to Big Buckhead Church, when he was forced to stop and wait for people to move along. As he sat there, an older Ford drove up behind him and then pulled alongside. People scrambled off the road to get out of the car's way. It stopped abruptly, and Ruffin looked over at its occupants, 2 white lawmen and a distraught black man in handcuffs. Ruffin knew the black man, Edmund Scott, his longtime friend. The driver was W. Clifford Brown, a Jenkins County police officer. In the back of the car with Scott sat Thomas Stevens, a Millen police night marshal. When he saw Ruffin, Scott frantically shouted to the white officers, "I can get him to stand my bond." Why the 2 white officers were at the black gathering is unclear. They had no warrant. Marshal Stevens was not even in his jurisdiction. In all likelihood, they were in search of illegal alcohol. Brown and Stevens were known for going after stills and liquor joints, known in many parts of the South as blind tigers. That spring, the National Prohibition Act was making its way through Congress. It would enforce the 18th Amendment, which banned the sale of liquor nationwide. But in Georgia, the ongoing murky contest between police and those who made, sold, and drank liquor was an old game. In 1907, the Georgia legislature, bowing to pressure from Baptists, passed a law banning alcohol. The law was enacted partly in response to the Atlanta race riot of 1906, when white mobs attacked blacks for 3 days. 25 blacks and one white were killed. White opponents of alcohol argued that heavy drinking in downtown saloons had been a catalyst for trouble, which they blamed primarily on blacks. The law, however, did little to suppress Georgia's thirst. By 1919, a thriving underground network of alcohol manufacturers and distributors operated across the state. The police, who were always white, played a running game of cat and mouse with still operators, many of whom were black. Sometimes police destroyed confiscated booze. Sometimes corrupt officers resold it. One newspaper reported that Brown, in only 3 months on the force, filed more than 100 cases against gamblers and liquor manufacturers. The same report said Brown suspected Scott and the Ruffins of running a still. L.W. Beach, a white superintendent over black sharecroppers at a nearby plantation, told a different story. Beach was at the festival that day, driving impoverished blacks who did not own buggies or wagons to and from the church for $1 a ride. He said Brown and Stevens were not investigating Scott or Ruffin. The white law officers claimed they arrested Scott, the festival's marshal of ceremonies, only after he brandished a weapon when they almost crashed into his car. Scott, who was driving a minister from another county to the fair, was infuriated by the officers' wild driving. Beach heard Scott say, "That is the way with some people. They haven't got a damn bit of manners." Brown and Stevens then arrested Scott, charging him with possession of an unregistered firearm. They were heading back to the mill and jail with Scott when they passed by Ruffin's car, and Scott shouted for help. Officer Brown stopped his car and called for Ruffin. Ruffin got out of his car, walked over, and stood on the running board of the police car. "What is the trouble with Edmund?" Ruffin asked. Officer Brown said they had found a concealed pistol in Scott's car. Beach, positioned about 30 feet away, saw Ruffin take out a checkbook and offered to write a bond check for his friend. The officer told him he needed cash. Ruffin said he could not get that kind of money, $400 on a Sunday. Brown then said, "God damn it, I am going to carry him in." A large crowd immediately gathered around the car, including two of Ruffin's sons, Lewis and John Holliday. People who were there said Ruffin reached in and tried to pull Scott out. Brown became incensed and shouted, "God damn it, get back!" He pulled out his pistol and struck Ruffin in the face. The gun went off, hitting Ruffin on the left side of his head, knocking him to the dirt. Ruffin said later he was unconscious for a few minutes. Others said he got up right away. One person who was there said Lewis, Joe's oldest son, rushed the car, wrested the gun from Brown, and shot the police officer in the head, neck, and body, killing him. Two others said that the father, Joe Ruffin, killed Brown, pulling out his own pistol and firing into the police car. Others said Officer Stevens, a short, heavy-set man, stepped out of the car, hunkered down with his pistol drawn. Another round of gunfire erupted. Scott, caught in the middle and handcuffed, was shot to death as he struggled to get out of the way. Stevens was wounded and slumped to the ground. "It was just like a package of poppers, firecrackers," said Ed Tansmore, a white man who saw the shooting, adding that it took no longer than a finger snap. In an instant, Brown and Scott were dead, slumped in the blood-smeared Ford. Stevens lay on the ground, bleeding but conscious. Black men in the crowd attacked him. Some said Ruffin's two sons led the assault. Tansmore watched as Stevens was beaten. Every time he would get up, they would knock him back until they got him down the side of the car, and one of them placed his foot in his breast, and the other handed him an oak limb, and right there they stopped him. Police later found a blood-soaked oak branch beside Stevens' mutilated body. A newspaper account described Stevens as a shapeless mass. He took as long as 2 hours to die. Ruffin said that after he was shot, he fell to the ground and did not know anything at all until my boy, Jay Holiday, and Willie Williams picked me up off the ground and went walking with me off to my car. Ruffin said his friend Williams tried to hand him the checkbook that he dropped when he was shot. Williams also offered him a gun. "No, keep them," Ruffin said. "I have got no use for them now at all. I better go to the doctor because I believe I am going to die." Someone, perhaps one of his sons, perhaps Williams, started Ruffin's Ford. Ruffin sat in the passenger seat, his head gushing with blood, his ears ringing from the gunshots. Smoke stung his nostrils as he looked upon the contorted corpses of a friend he had known his whole life, and a white law officer. The other officer, Stevens, writhed on the ground, mortally wounded. Surveying the scene, Ruffin knew immediately he would be lynched when the white mob came for him. And there was no doubt it would come, if he lived that long. Word of the incident spread farmhouse by farmhouse across the county. The word traveled along two distinct vectors, black and white. Blacks hid in their homes, while hundreds of white men grabbed their guns and headed toward Carswell Grove. As Ruffin was rushed from the scene, he asked to be taken to the home of the only person who could help him, Jim Perkins, the most powerful white man in Jenkins County, whose farm was 3 miles from the shooting. Perkins, the chairman of the Board of Commissioners, had known Ruffin his whole life. Perkins was waiting at a nearby train depot when a black man told him a wounded Joe Ruffin had arrived at his farm. Perkins rushed home. Ruffin recalled telling Perkins, "I was only trying to offer him, Brown, a bond for Edmund, and he got mad and shot me down for nothing." Perkins remembered Ruffin telling him, "Mr. Brown shot me, and it made me so mad I jumped up and emptied my pistol at him." Perkins was baffled that Ruffin was in trouble. "I consider he came to me because he didn't know where to go or what to do," he said later. Perkins got the county jail physician, J.R. Littleton, to bandage Ruffin's head, and then drove to meet the county sheriff, M.G. Johnson, at the scene of the shooting. The two men saw the dead Brown and Scott and the dying Stevens. When the gathering white farmers learned Ruffin was alive and at Perkins's house, they became incensed. Perkins and Sheriff Johnson rushed back to protect him. Ruffin sat bandaged on a cot in a cook's shed when Perkins and Johnson burst in. "Joe, come on, a mob is coming after you," they yelled. They had Ruffin lie in the back of Perkins's Cadillac, then drove north as fast as they could. Cars filled with angry white men pursued them all the way to Waynesboro, the seat of the next county. Perkins and Johnson then decided to drive on to the nearest big city, Augusta, about 45 miles away. They arrived about 6:30 p.m. and put Ruffin in the jail there. Ruffin recalled his jailer told him he had, "Better be proud, Mr. Johnson and Mr. Perkins brought me for safekeeping, and I told him I was." As Ruffin lay in his cell, mobs took vengeance in Jenkins County. In the first of many acts of violence that night, white men with guns charged the church at Carswell Grove, firing as they came. Congregants jumped through windows and took off into the woods. Mothers tossed children through the windows and then scrambled behind them. The mob torched the building. Smoke and flames could be seen for miles as dusk descended. White men went to Ruffin's farm and grabbed his youngest son, Henry. No account mentions the whereabouts of Ruffin's daughters. They apparently fled. Somewhere near the church, the mob also grabbed another Ruffin, John Holiday. Lewis Ruffin escaped. The mob took Ruffin's car and drove the two boys back to the roaring fire at the remains of the Carswell Grove Church. The mob burned Ruffin's car, one of the clearest symbols of the black man's relative wealth. White men then hung a wagon trace chain around one son's neck and a rope around the other's. They threw both of Ruffin's sons into the flames. It is not clear whether they were dead when they were tossed into the fire. At some point, the bodies were shot. When the corpses were examined the next day, it was impossible to tell which son suffered the chain and which got the rope. The mob next moved south to Millen. 3 black Masonic lodges were torched. At least 2 more cars owned by blacks were destroyed. 1 black man was shot and wounded. Mob members told a reporter that the man was at fault for acting suspiciously by running away when they approached. There were reports of other blacks murdered in remote sections of the county. The crescendo of the mob's work in Millen was the abduction and lynching of Ruffin's friend Willie Williams, who had helped him get up after being shot. Sheriff's deputies took him into custody, presumably for his own safety. First, they put him in the county jail near the courthouse. When they learned a mob was searching for Williams, they hid him in a nearby stable. But a mob easily found Williams. They dragged him 3 miles outside of town to a remote swamp hollow. They tortured him and then shot him to death. Word came from the mob that before he died, Williams confessed to a plot to kill Brown because of his anti-liquor activities, though he would not tell the mob where Lewis Ruffin, allegedly wounded, was hiding. Blacks lured the white law officers into a trap, the story went. Another black man who was arrested, Jim Davis, also confessed to the plot, and his life was spared. The story made its way without any evidence or attribution into news accounts of the lynchings, offering white readers moral justification for what happened. Whites cast the killings, as all lynchings were presented, as lex talionis, the law of retribution. The morning of April 14th, the Augusta Chronicle ran a front-page banner headline in capital letters, "Race Riot at Millen, Negro in Jail Here." The Macon Telegraph reported the day after the lynchings that hundreds of whites came to Carswell Grove and found the church a charred ruin. The bodies of the two Ruffins, what was left of them, were still lying on the ground. White reporters filed stories from the telegraph office of the Millen Depot, spreading the news across the country. The Telegraph reported Millen's blacks circulating a petition asking whites not to burn down any more of their churches. Black Masons in Jenkins wrote to the Atlanta Independent, the main black newspaper in the state, to solicit donations to rebuild their destroyed lodges. The letter never mentioned the lynchings, but only pleaded for money to help us in our trouble, as none of us know just where and when our troubles are coming. The published accounts were full of inaccuracies, ranging from minor misspellings to confusion over whether the mob had lynched Lewis Ruffin. No newspaper, white or black, ever definitively reported how many people were killed. The number ranged from 4 to 7. In many of the stories, hearsay blended with fact, and prejudice assumed the guise of accepted wisdom. White mob members were not quoted or named. Blacks were not interviewed. White newspapers discounted the riot as a regrettable aberration as soon as it was over. "All is quiet again," assured Jenkins County journalist John Gordon Ellison in the April 16th Atlanta Constitution. "The innocent will have nothing to fear." Black newspapers, in the midst of a golden age of growth across the country, ran the Jenkins County story and put their own agenda onto the bare facts. At the time, the Chicago Defender was the nation's largest black newspaper, with a circulation of more than 100,000. Much of that circulation penetrated the Deep South, where most of America's more than 10 million blacks lived. The Defender's defense of black rights, sharp criticism of Jim Crow, an ardent call for Southern blacks to migrate to Northern cities, aroused deep hatred from Southern whites. Southern legislators moved to ban its distribution. Black readers loved it. On April 19th, the Defender picked up the Jenkins County story with the headline, "White Officer is Killed for Breaking Up Church." The Defender story laid blame on the white police officers for trying to break up a revival meeting and turn the piece into a pro-migration story. "It appears to have been another case of too much of the Southern idea of interfering with our people, this part of the country representing the usual type of Georgia's civilization," the article read. Some suggested whites were threatened by the economic success that black men like Ruffin embodied. William Pickens, famed dean of the black Morgan State University in Baltimore, wrote about the clash on the front page of the Washington Bee, a newspaper serving what was then the nation's largest black urban population. Pickens wrote that Ruffin, one of the wealthiest Negroes in Jenkins County, had been shot, and his sons lynched in part because whites were jealous of his wealth. This disposition of the South to govern the Negro without his consent or participation, to really keep the Negro down, will make trouble to the end of it, he added. The Savannah Tribune, a black weekly, declared the violence was a reaction to the rising economic status of Southern black farmers. The root cause, it argued, was a deep-seated envy and animosity toward a few thrifty and industrious Negroes there who committed no worse wrong than to appropriate to themselves the right and privilege to own pleasure automobiles to enjoy and break the monotony of their Sundays. The editorial stated, "The tension and stress of racial hate and envy is so unnecessary and so unwarranted that it cannot obtain for many years more. Negro progress will continue. The attitude and opposition of the lawless, shiftless lynching elements must yield." But the white mobs did not yield. They roamed Jenkins County for days. They grabbed a black man from neighboring Burke County, believing he was Lewis Ruffin. Only when the terrified man was brought back to Millen and properly identified did they turn him loose. The mob made threats to get Joe Ruffin from jail in Augusta. When his jailers heard a mob was headed their way, they sent Ruffin to a jail in Aiken, South Carolina. Even out of state, Ruffin had no idea whether a white mob might show up some night to lynch him. Sending mobs far distances to kill people was not without precedent in Georgia. Georgia led the nation in lynchings in 1918 and had the most lynchings of any state since anyone had cared to keep records. In a notorious case in 1915, a mob traveled over several counties to kidnap Leo Frank, a Jewish businessman, and lynch him for the alleged rape and murder of a young white girl, Mary Fagan. Hugh Dorsey, the prosecutor handling the Frank case, had been mortified by the lynching, which made national news and outraged Jews across the country. Dorsey became governor after Frank's death in part due to a promise to crack down on lynching. In early 1919, Dorsey drafted legislation to authorize the state to seize control of sheriff's departments and levy fines against county officials who did not suppress lynching. A day after the Carswell Grove lynchings, a reporter found Dorsey at a hotel in Macon and asked him about the violence. "I have put in a call for the sheriff," he said, "and if the county authorities wish any state aid, the National Guard organizations at Savannah can be quickly rushed to the scene of the trouble." No such request was ever made. Jenkins County would handle the trouble itself. The county prosecutor charged Joe Ruffin with the murders of Officer Brown and Scott and ordered that he be returned for trial. If Ruffin made it to trial without being lynched, his conviction was certain, and his hanging would follow. No white person was ever arrested or charged with any crime relating to the riots and lynchings of April 13th or the destruction of the church and other buildings. Perkins, the county commission chairman, who had rushed Ruffin to safety, ruled that no inquest regarding the white attackers was necessary. At some point, someone, perhaps a jailer who read newspaper accounts of the lynching, told Ruffin that two of his sons were dead. "This is an awful thing. It is awful," Ruffin moaned later. "I am sorry for Mr. Brown. I am also sorry for Mr. Stevens. I am sorry for their families. But there has been nobody suffered in this matter like I have. I did not do nothing at all to cause that riot." The Jenkins County riot was not an isolated tragedy. In coming months, similar horrors would afflict cities and towns across America. The violence that April Sunday was only the beginning of what would become known as the Red Summer of 1919, when riots and lynchings spread throughout the country, causing havoc and harming thousands, yet also awakening millions of blacks to fight for rights guaranteed them, but so long denied. Chapter 2. Things Fall Apart. "America, will you let us fall, after we so bravely answered your call? Now why, oh why, is freedom's door closed against us, as it was before?" Burris Alexander, Black Soldier. The year 1919 was supposed to be one of triumphant peace and universal fellowship. Speaking in the United Kingdom, as 1918 drew to a close, President Woodrow Wilson declared the world had united to defeat autocracy. With the war over, he said, "We shall now be drawn together in a combination of moral force that is irresistible." In the United States, many people, including black families with returning soldiers, fervently hoped 1919 would usher in a new epoch of peace, prosperity, and freedom. Black soldiers and workers believed their participation in the effort to make the world safe for democracy had earned them the equal rights they had been promised in the Constitution since the close of the Civil War. Emmett J. Scott, Assistant to Secretary of War Newton Baker, and the highest-ranking black official in the Wilson administration, predicted the black soldier would return home with a broader vision of American citizenship and an appreciation of what liberty and freedom really meant. "He will be anxious to renew and strengthen the friendly relations he left behind, confident that a spirit of justice abides in the land to which he is returning," Scott told dignitaries at the Tuskegee Institute in Alabama. But African Americans received no such welcome, despite their service in France. The lynchings and burning of Carswell Grove Baptist Church proved to be the toxin of anti-black riots and lynchings that would sweep the nation from April to November 1919, as racial unrest rolled through the South, North, Midwest, and into the nation's capital. It would be the worst spate of race riots and lynchings in American history. Even in the disordered 1960s, famed black historian John Hope Franklin considered 1919 as the greatest period of interracial strife the nation has ever witnessed. James Weldon Johnson, the field secretary of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People in 1919, called this season the Red Summer because it was so bloody. The violence enveloped towns, counties, and large cities, from Texas to Nebraska, Connecticut to California. Though no complete and accurate records on the months of violence were compiled, analysis of newspaper accounts, government documents, court records, and NAACP files show at least 25 major riots and mob actions erupted, and at least 52 black people were lynched. Many victims were burned to death. Riots were often over in hours, but some immobilized cities like Chicago, Washington, Knoxville, and Elaine, Arkansas for days. Millions of Americans had their lives disrupted. Hundreds of people, most of them black, were killed, and thousands more were injured. Tens of thousands were forced to flee their homes or places of work. Businesses lost millions of dollars to destruction and looting. In almost every case, white mobs, whether sailors on leave, immigrant slaughterhouse workers, or southern farmers, initiated the violence. Some had predicted this trouble as black soldiers and stevedores returned home after fighting for democracy in Europe. The return of the Negro soldier to civil life is one of the most delicate and difficult questions confronting the nation, North and South, wrote George Haynes, Fisk University professor and director of Negro economics for the United States Department of Labor. In the first months after the war's abrupt end, blacks hoped they had won a new place in American society. It was a plastic moment, as historian Richard Slotkin put it, when racial boundaries seemed to undulate and the social order expanded, possibly to allow a new place for blacks. On February 17, 1919, 3,000 black soldiers of the 369th Infantry Regiment of the 15th New York National Guard paraded triumphantly through Manhattan up to Harlem. The Harlem Hellfighters, as they were called, had distinguished themselves in combat, and they returned home to cheers from New Yorkers, most of them white, lining the avenues. A World reporter declared the soldiers' dark skin made no difference in the shouts and flag-waving and handshakes that were bestowed upon the regiment. But soon, race relations frayed, and goodwill from the war dissipated. Many whites resorted to threats and violence to reassert their old dominance. Most politicians did not see the rising potential for riots or lynching. Some openly endorsed such anti-black violence when it came. Others said there was little they could do to stop it. Most delayed and bungled when faced with crises. Blacks, who had seen themselves on the cusp of true equality, became confused and angry. Corporal Burris Alexander, who served with engineers in France, composed a plaintive poem that captured black sentiment. America, will you let us fall after we so bravely answered your call? Now why, oh why, is freedom's door closed against us as it was before? Yet something amazing happened as the mobs rose up. They encountered black men and women transformed by their experiences during the war, whether in European trenches, on the factory floors of northern cities, or in the cotton fields of the South. The economic, social, and political dynamics of black-white relations were changing. African Americans fought back in large numbers. They retaliated immediately, picking up guns and firing on approaching mobs. They also organized and transformed political organizations, primarily the NAACP, to challenge the violence in the political arena and the courts. The white attacks, and importantly the black reaction to them, emboldened blacks across the country and made 1919 a turning point in American race relations. William Edward Burghardt, W.E.B. Du Bois, head of the NAACP's publications and editor of its monthly magazine, The Crisis, saw black troops returning from victory in Europe as a civil rights vanguard. By the God of heaven, we are cowards and jackasses if now that the war is over, we do not marshal every ounce of our brain and brawn to fight a sterner, long, more unbending battle against the forces of hell in our own land, he announced. Black journalist William Allison Sweeney declared early in 1919 that the idea of keeping blacks oppressed after the war was the graveyard yawp of a dying monster. The day has dawned, and the start has been made, Sweeney wrote in his popular History of the American Negro in the Great World War. Before the noontime, America will be prouder of her Negro citizens and will be a happier, a more inspired and inspiring nation, a better home for all her people. Average black men also felt this energy. Stanley B. Norvell, a black veteran awarded French medals for bravery, wrote to a white newspaper editor that the war had aroused desires for true equality and freedom. The 500,000 Negroes who were sent overseas to serve their country were brought into contacts that widened both their perceptions and their perspectives, broadened them, gave them new angles on life, on government, and on what both mean, wrote Norvell, then living in Chicago. They are now new men and world men, if you please, and their possibilities for direction, guidance, honest use, and power are limitless. Only they must be instructed and led. They have awakened, but they have not yet the complete conception of what they have awakened to. In the first months of 1919, black culture and society radiated a new vitality and hope. In New York, Harlem expanded with theaters, cabarets, restaurants, and a budding literary scene. Caribbean immigrants poured in, bringing new forms of music and poetry and espousing fresh political theories. Jazz sank roots in Chicago's South Side, the black capital of the Midwest. Black theaters became popular. A black film industry developed. Black communities, including many in southern towns, launched publications modeled after the established and profitable Chicago Defender. The NAACP's The Crisis gained tens of thousands of readers. Black clubs and Masonic lodges attracted members. Black-themed books drew healthy sales. The year saw the first mass manufacture of black dolls for children. Teach your children pride of race and appreciation of race, an advertisement for the dolls read. Fittingly, one was a soldier in uniform. Yet, despite this uplift, blacks had virtually no political power in early 1919. The last black congressman had left office in 1901. Across the South, governments disenfranchised blacks. In the North, their votes only mattered when concentrated in a few urban areas. But the young black writer Gene Toomer, in one of his first published writings, declared the riots to be the start of a new era in American race relations. As long as the Negro here was passive, the true solution of the race problem could wait, he wrote in a socialist New York newspaper. The South burned and lynched, and the North aided by its silence. But now, with a Negro openly resolved and prepared to resist attacks upon his person and privileges, the condition assumes a graver aspect. Immediate steps toward cooperative relations are imperative. It now confronts the nation. The violence hit the United States amid a profusion of other national and international crises that swirled about after a war so bloody, damaging, and horrific that all anyone could think to call it was the Great War. A new map of Europe emerged, with nations born from collapsed empires. Radicals saw the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia as an opportunity to reorder the world. The rest of the world trembled. White Russian armies, aided by American and British troops, fought the Reds from the Baltic to Siberia. Marxists led uprisings in German cities, only to be crushed by right-wing Freikorps. Bela Kun tried to establish a communist state in Hungary, but the revolt was put down. British colonial troops mowed down rioters in India, Jamaica, and elsewhere. The genocide of Armenians by the Turks, begun in 1915 and resulting in 1 million deaths, came to light in early 1919. Thousands of Jews were killed in pogroms in Ukraine. Influenza, which had killed tens of millions around the world, continued to take lives. William Butler Yeats captured the pervading dread and worldwide chaos in his poem, The Second Coming. Things fall apart. The center cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. In the United States, the Allied victory did not mean peace. Instead, uncertainty permeated political discourse and social interaction. For the first time, census takers found that the majority of Americans lived in cities. In 1919, women secured the right to vote. Prohibition was set to become national law. The year would see the founding of two American Communist parties, a national crackdown on subversives, and an explosion of strikes and labor unrest. Amid the chaos, blacks were attacked with impunity. The 1919 racial violence came at a pivotal moment in American history, ushered in by a confluence of forces, including the rise of Jim Crow, the Great Migration, and urbanization, plus an economic downturn exacerbated by hundreds of thousands of job-seeking veterans home from the Great War. The nation appeared to be collapsing before the challenges. A growing fear was radicalism. Talk of revolution and the rise of white supremacist movements unnerved many Americans. The Red Summer arrived in tandem with the Red Scare, which was rolling across Europe and into America. Clearly, the old social order was breaking down. Race played a major role in the unrest. Small-minded politicians and irresponsible journalists seized on racial violence to promote agendas and careers. The rising black press worked to counter biased coverage, but most white newspapers, from the New York Times to the Jackson Daily News in Mississippi, favored whites in their reports, blaming blacks for initiating trouble. Those who spoke out in favor of the rule of law were shouted down. Courageous political leaders were largely absent. It seemed the Great War had upset everything, settling nothing. Chapter 3. The World is on Fire. We have found, from bitter experience, and this case is no exception, that we cannot depend upon the police, the posse of the sheriff, or the militia. Chicago Defender, April 5th, 1919. The Jenkins County riot was not an isolated event. In many places, whites battled blacks over where they lived, where they worked, and how they voted. On April 13th, the same day blood was shed at Carswell Grove, a group of white men in Metcalf, Mississippi, kidnapped a black minister. A week later, the Reverend John H.F. West was still missing. Around 3 a.m. on April 14th, a mob looking for a black man accused of shooting a white police officer attacked a plantation near Fitzgerald, Georgia. The mob could not find him, so it burned down a black church on the property. On April 22nd, a scuffle between three white military guards and black civilians near the naval yards at Newport News, Virginia, led to a near riot after a guard shot a black girl in the foot. Military police later arrested 16 black men, but they escaped when hundreds of others rushed the jail. In what was to become a standard line in news reports during 1919, the story ended, "The authorities declare that they are anticipating no more serious trouble." Yet, an armed mob stopped a train on April 29th near Monroe, Louisiana. George Holden, a black man, was dragged from the train, then shot to death. He was accused of writing an insulting note to a white woman. A coroner's jury convened later that day declared that Holden came to his death by unknown causes. Racial violence was not limited to the South. In Chicago, black and Irish gangs fought along Wentworth Avenue, one of the city's racial dividing lines. Brickbats, clubs, and bullets were used promiscuously, and many on each side were hurt, the Associated Press reported. Racial feeling has been gaining in intensity, the police say, since the encroachment of Negroes from what is known as the South Side Black Belt into a district further southward. The article did not mention another cause of tension. On April 1st, Mayor Big Bill Thompson, a Republican, won a second term after a campaign labeled perhaps the most acrid ever waged in Chicago. Black support for Thompson inflamed his white opponents, who saw him as using blacks to check their advance. "All the prejudiced tom-toms were sounding furiously," an observer noted. In the North, returning veterans had trouble finding jobs, since few factories were hiring, and Southern black migrants had filled many jobs. On April 19th, a federal official in Chicago, working to place veterans in jobs, reported to superiors that he was urging blacks to return to the South. Black migrants were not receptive, he said, because the black worker knew what conditions and wages are, and there is nothing that I know of that could induce him to return if he prefers to stay north. In the South, employers grew desperate for black labor. On April 22nd, John D. Baker, head of the Chamber of Commerce in Jacksonville, Florida, wrote to a federal veterans employment office in Chicago begging for cheap black workers. "We people of the South understand the Negro laborer," he wrote, "and the large employers of labor in this section of the country prefer the working of Negroes to the white man, especially in the turpentine camps, sawmills, and upon the plantations, for these men understand this work and give better satisfaction than the white man." That spring, Emmett Scott, the black assistant secretary at the War Department, sent a special report to the director of the National Defense Council. "The war had completely upset the American economy and race relations," he wrote, "thus presenting social and economic problems, upon the proper solution of which will largely depend the future security, welfare, and prosperity of both white and colored Americans." In early April, the nation was reminded of a recent spasm of racial violence with the murder conviction of Leo Bundy, a black dentist and local political leader from East St. Louis, Illinois. An all-white jury found that Bundy conspired to murder white detectives and incited a riot on July 2, 1917. National news coverage of Bundy's trial and conviction awakened ugly memories of the young century's worst race riot. Thousands of whites had attacked black neighborhoods of the factory town known with derision as the Hoboken of St. Louis. An estimated 6,000 blacks fled across the Mississippi River to St. Louis as white mobs burned and ransacked black homes and businesses. Future international entertainer Josephine Baker, then an 11-year-old living in St. Louis, likened it to the apocalypse. "The entire black community appeared to be fleeing," she recalled. At least 40 blacks and 8 whites were killed. White union members, fuming at black union busters, led the riot. Illinois militia were sent to quell them, but did little to protect black victims. In some instances, soldiers participated in the violence. When asked by a congressional committee what he saw soldiers doing during the riot, a white witness replied tersely, "Shooting Negroes." The 1917 riot shocked a nation that had entered the European conflict claiming to end German atrocities against Belgian civilians. Black activists and journalists across the country were outraged. White leaders were embarrassed. President Woodrow Wilson's press secretary found accounts of the riot too sickening to read. Yet, despite national calls for a presidential investigation, Wilson remained silent. A political cartoon in the New York Evening Mail pictured an East St. Louis black mother cowering with two children and pleading to Wilson, "Mr. President, why not make America safe for democracy?" A hatchet-faced Wilson glared without comment. Bundy, who had argued that blacks should use force to defend themselves against white mobs, was charged with the murder of two police officers. Scant evidence linked Bundy to the shooting, but he was extradited from Cleveland. At first, black activists and white liberals set up committees for his legal defense. Newly appointed NAACP field secretary, James Weldon Johnson organized a 10,000-person silent march down Fifth Avenue in New York to protest the East St. Louis riot and lynchings in general. The NAACP sent a delegation, including Johnson, to the White House with a petition declaring, "No nation that seeks to fight the battles of civilization can afford to march in blood-smeared garments." Wilson declined to see the visitors. All this ugliness was revived in the spring of 1919 with Bundy's trial, held in the small community of Waterloo, Illinois, 20 miles from East St. Louis. Bundy's lawyers savaged prosecution witnesses and provided ample evidence that Bundy was not involved in the murders or in the riot that followed. The jury still found him guilty. Blacks across the country were livid. The Chicago Defender called it a shameful miscarriage of justice, saying Illinois Governor Frank Loudon caused the riot by waiting too long to send in the militia and did little to enforce troop discipline once he finally did. A little exercise of executive backbone at the proper moment might have resulted in the saving of many lives and in preventing the destruction of thousands of dollars worth of valuable property, a Defender editorial stated on April 5, 1919. It might have kept the great state of Lincoln and Grant from stepping into the same column with Texas and Mississippi. The editorial closed with a declaration that would prove prescient. There is but one way to deal with a mob, that is, to prepare for it, and when you see it in action, move to meet it with every weapon at your command. We have found from bitter experience, and this case is no exception, that we cannot depend upon the police, the posse of the sheriff, or the militia. Claude McKay, a 29-year-old Jamaican immigrant, railroad porter, and aspiring poet, published a poem that April in the New York-based leftist publication, The Liberator. The poem was called The Dominant White, and it served as a muscular rebuke of the prevailing attitude that whites were a superior race destined to rule the world. "God gave you power to build and help and lift, but you proved prone to persecute and slay, and from the high and noble course to drift into the darkness from the light of day." The poem closed with an explicit threat. "Oh, white man, you have trifled with your trust, and God shall humble you down to the dust." McKay was little known at the time. Within months, however, he published If We Must Die, a poem that would make him famous as the de facto poet laureate of the cause of black self-defense. A few whites picked up on the shift in black attitude. In January, the 73-year-old Moorfield Story, a Boston Brahmin lawyer and the NAACP's first president, noted that discharged black soldiers, just beginning to return to the country, were not disposed to accept the treatment to which they have been subjected. "I foresee a serious crisis." But most whites did not see this seething racial tension in the spring of 1919. In fact, many assumed race relations were improving. On the same day as the Carswell Grove violence, the New York Times published a letter to the editor titled After the War South, An Improvement in Social Temper and Racial Feeling with Return of Troops. Progressive educator James Hardy Dillard argued that the war had smoothed relations. "People in the South know that the race problem is there, know from time to time, in this place and that, some fool or fools of one race or the other will act according to their folly and make trouble. But there is a mysterious wisdom in the great body of the people in the South and elsewhere, which keeps them going on with their ordinary lives and in a sort of subconscious way guides them, as if they had reasoned out the fact that time alone can cure some ills, and that meantime occasional aches and pains will occur. You could easily make a month's tour in the South and forget all about lynching and other damnable things. Dillard was no Jim Crow apologist. His credentials as an advocate for black education and racial harmony were unequaled among Southern whites. Born to Tidewater, Virginia aristocracy in 1856, Dillard seemed destined for a comfortable life within the confines of the elite institutions of Southern education. Instead, he spent his life monitoring race relations and working to improve educational opportunities for blacks. A key goal, he wrote, was to help transform the average white man's attitude towards the Negro. Dillard was president of two national funds for black education. He co-founded the Southern University Race Commission, which attempted to lead a Christian men's movement against lynching. In 1918, he engineered formation of the Atlanta-based Commission on Interracial Cooperation. The group of religious leaders and academics worked to set up biracial committees to ease tension in every county of every state in the South. Many Americans considered Dillard one of the keenest experts on what was called the Negro problem. So when the 62-year-old wrote the Times from his home in Charlottesville, editors gave the letter prominent display. Dillard had finished a 3-week tour of the South, talking with people of both races, men and women, educated and uneducated. He recounted meeting a white Alabama Baptist minister, roughly his own age, on a train. When the minister saw black soldiers standing on a railway platform, he remarked that the men should get the right to vote if they met qualifications. Dillard took this anecdote as a sign of progress. Dillard wrote to the Times with one clear purpose: to allay concerns regarding racial tension. Mob violence, he argued, was on the wane. Most blacks considered Dillard's views deluded. Walter White, the NAACP's young assistant field secretary, wrote an internal memo to James Weldon Johnson about Dillard's piece. "The colored man of the South is not satisfied, nor is he so busy that he doesn't think of the race problem," he wrote. "Not a day can pass but he is reminded vividly of it, and such constant reminders are not conducive towards forgetting." Dillard was not the only Pollyanna. A group of Southern University professors from institutions like the University of Alabama, the University of Mississippi, and the University of North Carolina banded together several years earlier and issued pamphlets calling for white college men to be more sympathetic toward blacks. They fell far short, however, of calling for equality. On April 26, 1919, the professors issued a new reconstruction, asking white college men to seek by all practicable means to cultivate a more tolerant spirit, a more generous sympathy, and a wider degree of cooperation between the best elements of both races, to emphasize the best rather than the worst features of interracial relations, to secure greater publicity for those whose views are based on reason rather than prejudice. These, we believe, are essential parts of the Reconstruction program, by which it is hoped to bring into the world a new era of peace and democracy. On the eve of unprecedented racial violence, many white political leaders and journalists embraced this romantic sentiment. For 2 years, Americans had been told incessantly that the war's end would bring global peace and prosperity, and that the nation was the most unified and patriotic on earth. But this propaganda began evaporating in the spring of 1919. War and economic hardship roamed the world, and the United States came close to being torn asunder along fault lines of race and labor. Isaac Frederick Marcuson, the popular economic and political writer, predicted in his The War After the War in 1917, "Peace will be as great a shock as war." While Germany and the Allies worked to finalize a treaty of surrender at Versailles, the world beyond the Grand Chateau's terraced gardens was falling apart. On April 13th, the same day as the Carswell Grove incident, British troops in Amritsar, India, fired on unarmed protesters, killing at least 379 men, women, and children, and wounding at least 1,100 more. Novelist John Dos Passos presented the global mood in his novel, 1919. The world's no fun anymore. Only machine gun fire and arson, starvation, lice, bedbugs, cholera, typhus. Victory left America feeling anxious and exhausted, not robust and triumphant. H.L. Mencken summed up the mindset of the average American. There is always something just ahead of him, beckoning him and tantalizing him. And there is always something just behind him, menacing him and causing him to sweat. In the spring, while working to negotiate a European peace in France, the prosaic President Wilson confided to his personal physician, "The world is on fire." Many Americans felt the same way. In late April, the black editors of the Cleveland Gazette wrote sardonically, "Nero thought he was some pumpkins when he fiddled for a few days while the city of Rome burned. Now we fiddle around 5 months while the whole world burns." Chapter 4. The NAACP. "Make way for democracy. We saved it in France, and by the great Jehovah, we will save it in the United States of America, or know the reason why." W.E.B. Du Bois, Returning Soldiers, The Crisis, May 1919. As Carswell Grove Church smoldered in Georgia, 12 men and one woman gathered Monday, April 14th, in the Manhattan offices of the NAACP. It is unlikely anyone there knew of Carswell Grove. A small item on the killings appeared in New York newspapers the next day. But this band of social workers and intellectuals was about to have its organization irrevocably transformed by the violence now spreading out from places like Jenkins County. Other black rights groups operated at the time, some older and better financed than the NAACP. William Monroe Trotter, editor of the black publication Boston Guardian, headed the National Equal Rights League, which traced its origins to the abolitionist movement of the 1840s. The National League on Urban Conditions Among Negroes, known as the Urban League, worked in industrial cities to improve the lives of black migrants. Black political organizations arose in different communities across the United States. The Lincoln League, founded in Memphis in 1916, was a Republican Party group for blacks that had set up chapters across the South and was about to establish the National Lincoln League of America. In 1917, Marcus Garvey established a division of his Universal Negro Improvement Association in his new home in Harlem. It was the first division of his organization outside of his native Jamaica. The UNIA flourished with chapters in major cities, including many in the South. Garvey promoted the UNIA with the group's weekly newspaper, The Negro World. All of these organizations played a role reacting to bloody 1919. But the NAACP would dominate. As the violence unfolded, blacks needed to channel a political response. In overwhelming numbers, they chose the NAACP. Just as the Chicago Defender became a main news source for blacks, the NAACP became the primary civil rights organization. After its founding in 1909, it was a small, somewhat sleepy group led by white do-gooders. But that began to change as it approached its 10th anniversary. Howard University professor Kelly Miller, one of the country's most well-known writers on black rights, wrote after the East St. Louis riot, "The United States thus becomes the world's most interesting laboratory for working out the intricate issues of race adjustment." The interplay between the NAACP and the Red Summer was to be one of that laboratory's most interesting experiments. Despite the organization's name, only three of those gathered for its April board meeting were black. What is obvious from the minutes, however, is that these three men, an intellectual lion, a literary and political dynamo, and a fearless young organizer, dominated the meeting with their reports. Soon they would dominate the organization, growing it to a size, strength, and reach never imagined by its white leaders. Their hard work and influence brought thousands of African Americans into the NAACP, helping it arise as the first sustained national black civil rights organization. The three had considerable talents and egos that sent them on different trajectories after the bloody 8 months. But for that crucial period, they complemented each other greatly and propelled the NAACP's transformation and growth. By far the most influential was W.E.B. Du Bois. The 51-year-old Du Bois, balding with a Van Dyke goatee and searching eyes, led a life marked by brilliant successes and tempestuous public arguments. Though Du Bois was greatly admired by many black and white activists, others found him imperious. Black writer George S. Schuyler, an Army veteran who was living in Harlem in 1919, satirized Du Bois as a pompous ass in his novel Black No More. Dr. Shakespeare Agamemnon Beard, whose haughty bearing never failed to impress both Caucasian and Negroes. Du Bois often fought with the NAACP board, and as the Red Summer began, he was battling with them over expenses for his recent trip to France. He knew he could be trying, and once wrote fellow NAACP board member Joel Spingarn, "I do not doubt in the least but that my temperament is a difficult one to endure. In my peculiar education and experience, it would be miraculous if I came through normal and unwarped." He was the first African-American to earn a doctorate at Harvard. His most influential book, The Souls of Black Folk, was published in 1903 and sparked controversy by criticizing Booker T. Washington, the era's famous conservative black leader and academic. Du Bois argued Washington had limited intellectual ambitions for African Americans and acquiesced to segregation. Du Bois was the only African American among the five people who founded the NAACP. In July 1910, he moved to New York to launch the crisis. Under Du Bois's editorship, it grew in prestige, circulation, and advertising revenue. In its pages, Du Bois advocated his program of fostering black leadership, which he called the Talented Tenth, his term for the favored few. Du Bois believed in elite education rather than work-study programs of the sort favored by Booker T. Washington. No organization like ours ever succeeded in America. Either it became a group of white philanthropists helping the Negro, like the anti-slavery societies, or it became a group of colored folk freezing out their white co-workers by insolence and distrust, he wrote Spingarn, his closest white friend, in 1914. Everything tends to break along the color line. How can this be changed? By changing it. By trusting black men with power. The organization started doing just that, bringing on black staffers whom Du Bois recommended. Another black man at the April meeting was James Weldon Johnson, the group's energetic field secretary. Du Bois recruited Johnson away from his life as an accomplished writer. "I am inclined to think that contact with human beings would be an incentive rather than a drawback to your literary work," Du Bois told him. Since joining the group, round-faced, gregarious Johnson traveled the Northeast and South, giving eloquent speeches and recruiting thousands of members. Using skills honed from years as a diplomat in Central America, Johnson also lobbied politicians in New York and Washington. Johnson, who considered himself a literary man, had found little time to write since taking the hectic job, which required constant travel and public speaking. "I simply cannot find the time, or better, the leisure to write poetry," he wrote to a friend in May 1919. Despite his peripatetic lifestyle, Johnson had produced some poems while on the road, until 1919, when he became too busy. At that April meeting, the 47-year-old Johnson was just back from a 2-week speaking tour to drum up support for an upcoming anti-lynching conference, the first such national meeting in New York City. The third black man, fair-skinned and with eyes so blue he could easily pass for Caucasian, was Walter White. At 25, he was the youngest in the room. He had just returned from a speaking tour of black churches and civic groups in New England, Virginia, and the Carolinas. Johnson had lured White, a natural salesman, from a career in insurance. Raised in Atlanta and a witness to that city's 1906 race riot, White attended Atlanta University, where Du Bois had taught and where Johnson had earned a degree. In 1917, White helped set up an Atlanta branch of the NAACP. His enthusiastic letters to the New York office impressed Johnson, who offered him a job as his assistant field secretary where you can put enthusiasm and draw out inspiration. Soon, White went undercover to investigate lynchings throughout the South. The pawky White claimed it was so easy for him to pass for Caucasian, he once was deputized to kill blacks while investigating a riot. This dangerous sleuthing, as he liked to call it, was perfect work for the chameleon-like White. Wrote biographer Kenneth Robert Jenkin, his easy manner, Atlanta roots, and White appearance gave him sources in mobs and Ku Klux Klan circles that were the journalists' envy. By April 1919, the three men had done much to help the NAACP grow. The crisis was approaching a circulation of 100,000. Johnson and White set up dozens of chapters and recruited thousands of members. In January 1918, the NAACP had 9,200 members. By April 1919, it had 51,023. Almost all of these new members were black, and most came to the organization by reading The Crisis or by hearing speeches from one of the three men. Still, the NAACP had yet to be tested politically, and critics discounted the organization as a gaggle of East Coast parlor socialists. The roster of board members present at the April meeting showed the criticism had some basis. The board's chair, Mary White Ovington, was a socialist and suffragette who helped found the NAACP. Spingarn, who that year founded the publishing house of Harcourt Brace and Company, was a wealthy advocate of progressive causes and a former literature professor at Columbia University. Both he and his younger brother, prominent lawyer Arthur Barnett Spingarn, supported the NAACP from its inception and served in various roles in the organization. The two Jewish brothers had both recently returned from serving in the army in Europe. The NAACP's leading white staffer, John R. Shalady, was an Irish-American social worker who had worked for several causes before joining the organization as secretary. Mary Ovington personified the white do-gooder leadership that dominated the NAACP's early years. Born in Brooklyn to left-leaning parents, she spent her life as a social worker helping New York's poor. As a young woman, she became interested in improving conditions for blacks after hearing Frederick Douglass speak. In 1904, she began a correspondence with Du Bois after reading The Souls of Black Folk. Following the Springfield, Illinois race riot of 1908, she brought together the group that formed the NAACP a year later. Throughout her involvement, Ovington embraced a genteel reserve that set a tone for other whites on the board.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.